In our previous example, we saw a sample calculation to determine the value of the entropy total of a system by adding together the entropy of reaction and adding to it the entropy of the surroundings calculated by this quantity. So again, as long as this is greater than zero, that tells us we have a spontaneous process. This equation can be used to determine spontaneity. However, we were going to modify this equation to develop a new quantity that will be used for the remainder of our calculations. And so we're going to modify this equation. And to do that, we start by multiplying this equation through by a negative t. As with all of our equations this semester, I will not ask you to duplicate this derivation. I'm simply showing it here to show you where it comes from. And so again, I am multiplying each quantity through by a negative t. In this last one, it means my t is going to cancel, as will my negative sign. This new quantity of negative t times the delta s total is a quantity labeled as delta g, and delta g is referred to as Gibbs free energy. I'll define that in a little bit more on the next slide or upcoming slide. And then to make the right side of our equation a little easier, I'm going to put my enthalpy first. It's always a little awkward to start with a negative sign. And so the enthalpy of a reaction will be subtracted by the temperature times the entropy of our reaction. The subscript we use on our delta G here is we are now calculating the free energy of reaction. So realize that it takes out the confusion of whether we're talking about the system or the surroundings. Everything is with respect to the reaction. So that's one benefit of referring to Gibbs free energy. Key thing to recognize in this equation. So realize in our initial equation, our total entropy needed to be a positive value to be spontaneous. But now that I've multiplied through by my negative t, realize that in order for a reaction to be spontaneous, if we're calculating delta g, this must now be a negative quantity. That is very important to know, to learn, and to memorize for this reaction. Delta G quantities must be less than zero or negative in order to be spontaneous reactions. So this final equation, we'll write it about 100 more times. Gibbs free energy, the delta G of reaction is calculated as the enthalpy of reaction minus temperature times the entropy of reaction. This equation is on your equation sheet, so you don't need to memorize it, but you'll use it enough. I expect you will. The next slide we have in our notes goes through the steps that I just mentioned, but the key is, of course, recognizing that is our main equation. And of course, that we're looking for a negative quantity to indicate spontaneity. All right, so our definition of Gibbs free energy. It is again Gibbs free energy, and that's where the G comes from. Sometimes it is just referred to as free energy, so those terms can be used interchangeably. And it is a quantity used to express spontaneity from the perspective of the system or of the reaction. So, in a technical definition, delta G is measured in units of kilojoules per mole. Again, it's going to be kilojoules. And it is defined as the maximum amount of energy that is available to do work on the surroundings. Obviously, in order to calculate it, we have to take into account both the enthalpy and the entropy of a system. And so, in a spontaneous process, at a constant temperature and pressure, the free energy of a system will always decrease. In a couple of videos, we'll look at graphs that illustrate this concept. So, if we look at Gibbs free energy from the perspective of work, we're trying to determine if a system is able to do work on the surroundings. In other words, if the reaction can happen. one thing to keep in mind is that the actual amount of work that is obtained is always going to be less than the maximum available. In any system, there is always some energy that is lost that's given off as some residual heat, light, sound, or et cetera, some other type of energy. So what we calculate is always the maximum amount, but in an ideal setting, just like in a percent yield calculation, we rarely get 100%. Like we've done with the other quantities in this chapter, I do like to ask you to predict the sign of delta G. And to do that, we have to look at both the sign of our enthalpy and our entropy. And again, just to reiterate, when we're describing a reaction to be spontaneous, that means that it's moving forward to reach equilibrium. So anytime we have a negative delta G value, it's moving forward. Anytime we have a positive delta G value, it means it's non-spontaneous. It means that reaction isn't going to keep going forward. It's actually going to move in the reverse direction. And again, we will define equilibrium in more detail in a little bit. Anytime our delta G is equal to zero, that is at equilibrium. Again, notice that we're describing here non-standard quantities of delta G. We do not have that not symbol above it. And so it's possible for these to equal zero. To predict our signs of delta G, I like to set up a table, writing my equation at the top, and again implying that these are all subscripts of reaction. What I like to do is look at the signs of enthalpy and entropy and then determine what my sign of delta G will be. We can do this both conceptually and mathematically. So conceptually, realize that exothermic reactions are favored, as are reactions that have an increase in disorder. So a negative delta H, a positive delta S. If I have that combination of signs, my value of delta G will always be negative. Now, if we look at it from a mathematical perspective, realize a negative delta H, here I have minus the temperature times my delta S. Remember, of course, temperature is in Kelvin, which can never be negative. So temperature will always be a positive value. So if I multiply these two together, I get a positive value. Negative minus a positive is always going to be negative. So let's quickly describe the opposite scenario. An endothermic reaction with a decrease in disorder, neither one of these factors is favored. So this is always going to be a positive delta G value, which means this reaction is never going to happen. So the first one we would say is always spontaneous at all temperatures. Recognize here that temperature is really the only factor that can change. Enthalpy and entropy values are set quantities for a reaction. And so when we say that it's spontaneous or non-spontaneous, we're describing temperature conditions. So now we look at what happens when we have the same signs. And these are actually the most common scenarios. It's really common for a reaction to have the same sign of enthalpy and entropy. Notice here, my enthalpy is favored because I have a negative enthalpy value that's favored. A negative entropy value is not favored. So this can be spontaneous, but it will be temperature dependent. So I'm going to use an abbreviation here, spont for spontaneity. What it means that is that in order for this reaction to be spontaneous, I need my quantity of enthalpy to be greater than the product of temperature times enthalpy. And the only way that can happen, again, temperature is the only thing that can change in here. So the only way that this can happen is if my reaction is run at what's considered a low, I'm going to put that in quotes, a low temperature. And I'll describe that more in 1 second. Let's look at our last possible combination where both values are positive. So again, if entropy is positive, that's favored. But a positive enthalpy is not favored. In order for this reaction to be spontaneous, it means that my temperature times entropy quantity needs to be greater than enthalpy. Again, if we look at the sign combination, because I have a subtraction in here, subtracting the positive value will give me a negative overall. And again, temperature is the only thing that can change. So the only way to make sure that my temperature times entropy outweighs enthalpy is if I have a relatively high temperature. Now, when we say high or low, those values are relative for a given reaction. In our next video, we'll describe how we calculate the temperature cutoff for a given reaction. In the textbook, they summarize your quantities of enthalpy and entropy in a table set up like this. What they're describing here is exactly what I set up in my outline here in this table. They just have it in a different format. So if you want another reference, the textbook describes it in this 4-cell table.